I'm Liz Faubliss, and this is Currents Week in Review. The Holy Father's pilgrimage of peace to Lebanon is underway. We have special coverage. The Manhattan Declaration for Religious Liberty crosses the river.
Trying to give people an understanding of how to have in the public forum our values understood.
And we remember a date that will live in our hearts forever.
Well, this is my hometown. And plus, we do have that awesome view of the World Trade Center, which I remember as a boy. And I gotta tell you, each day going to work, I miss those towers. It was like a family member.
Good evening and thank you for joining us. Pope Benedict is now in Lebanon on a pilgrimage of peace, while in the north of the country, new violence has claimed at least one life. At the Beirut airport, cheering children, the president and prime minister of Lebanon and a host of religious leaders greeted the Holy Father. Music filled the air, banners with the Pope's picture and signs proclaiming love for him were on display. Speaking on the tarmac, Benedict said he has come symbolically to all of the countries of the Middle East as a pilgrim for peace, as a friend of God, and as a friend to all. Earlier on the airplane, speaking with reporters, the Pope demanded an immediate halt to all shipments of weapons into Syria. He said importing arms into a country now being ripped apart by civil war is, quote, a grave sin. He also said the Arab Spring uprisings are a cry for freedom, but must include tolerance for all. Little tolerance was on display, however, miles north of the Pope in Tripoli, Lebanon. At least one person is dead as rioters burned down a KFC, Hardee's Restaurant Complex Theater, and tore down some banners welcoming the Pope. At least 25 people have been injured, including 18 police wounded while trying to restore order. The rioters shouted slogans against the Pope and the U.S., screaming, "Listen, listen, Obama, we are all Osama." The one person killed was a protester. Authorities blamed the anti-Islam film that now has sparked 4 days of violence throughout the Middle East. Calm only returned in Tripoli when the army took to the streets. Meanwhile, all was calm and solemn inside St. Paul's Basilica in the mountain village of Harissa as the Pope conducted the centerpiece ceremony of the first day of his three-day trip. He signed an official document reflecting on the situation of Christians in the Middle East. The Pope explained the document is based upon the works of a synod of bishops, 255 church leaders held in Rome 2 years ago. Benedict told his fellow Christians he knows their suffering and urged them to respond with forgiveness and not revenge. And in words reminiscent of his predecessor John Paul II, Benedict said, quote, "I encourage you not to be afraid." Lebanon is home to the many Christians and many rites. The greatest number are Maronite Catholics. I talked about the Pope's trip last week with Maronite Bishop Gregory Mansour of Brooklyn. Bishop, we've been hearing so much about the Pope's visit to Lebanon, and of course, aside from the historic value of it, the concern for the Holy Father's safety is definitely at the fore of many of our minds. What type of safety precautions, in your experience, do you think are being taken ahead of this visit?
The state just today decided to call off the day for everybody, for school, for work, for everybody. The army is on high alert. And everybody seems to be concerned about his safety except for him.
He doesn't seem in any of the interviews.
He has not budged, especially what's going on, unfortunately, in Syria between the government forces and the rebel forces and the Christians being caught in between, and some of the skirmishes coming over the border in Lebanon. From the very beginning, there was no doubt he is going to Lebanon.
And there are about 1 million Catholics in Lebanon. Based on my research, the majority follow a number of different rites of the Catholic Church, mostly Maronite. Bishops of the region met to discuss the theme, the Catholic Church in the Middle East, communion and witness. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Our own Patriarch Bashara Peter Rai, wrote after 1 year of service as a Patriarch, communion and love, Sharika wa mahabba, and he used those words on purpose because he felt he could attract Christians who are not Catholic, Muslims, Shiite and Sunni, and he felt he could draw them together on his pastoral visits when he goes. And now when the Holy Father comes, the entire region, Christian and Muslim, is going to come out to meet him.
There's an urgency based on everything I've read and in conversations that I've had with you ahead of this interview over regional political situations. There needs to be a deliberation about that. How are Catholic faith-based leaders in the region going to gather with the Pope in order to facilitate these deliberations and hopefully come to some kind of understanding as to how we can foster more communion?
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, it's an amazing reality that there is so much communion there already. In the Catholic schools, there are 360 Catholic schools, just talking about Lebanon. Mm-hmm. 28% of the people that go to those Catholic schools are non-Christian. So it would be Muslim, Shiite, Sunni, or Druze. The five major Catholic communities work very closely together, of course, with the leadership of the Maronite Patriarch, in all kinds of endeavors, from schools, universities, nursing homes, drug rehabilitation centers, homes for the handicapped, homes for the elderly. The spirit of Christianity is alive and very well in Lebanon. And in the Middle East, the Christians are the caregivers. They're the ones who have lived this mm-hmm. communion and have lived this witness and still do.
You've also expressed concern, though, that there is a considerable exodus of Christians from the region.
Yes.
and a sort of disconnect with the universal church. Are those also issues that are going to be addressed? It's a very short visit for the Pope next week, so it's going to be difficult for him to cover so many challenges in that short time.
I'm so eager to his words, and everybody will listen to very carefully, because the Holy Father has a way, even when he comes in very difficult situations, as he did in when he visited the Holy Land, he knows how to say something to someone who he can give them a challenge with a sweet invitation. And he'll do that for the Catholic community, he'll do that for the greater Christian community, he'll do that for the Muslim community as well. But how can we stop the exodus from the Middle East? That's up to us also in the West, mm-hmm. To assist them. I work very hard.
In what way?
In their hospitals, in their nursing homes, in drug rehabilitation centers, in their high schools, mm-hmm. and colleges and schools, to help be affordable for the... Right now, there's 60,000 refugees from Syria coming, many of them Christian. They'll be absorbed. We absorb the Assyrian and the Chaldean and the Syriac Catholics and Orthodox from Iraq.
Is there a lack of information, a lack of understanding?
Most people in the West have no idea what Christians. They have no idea how their brother and sister Christians are really the salt of the earth, and how they get up every day in their old cars and drive as nurses or as teachers and do it day in and day out, and do it on pennies, and they do it because they really love our Lord Jesus Christ, and they are not going to leave. They don't want to leave.
So we have a great responsibility to become more
just
informed.
To support them. Yeah, be informed. Mm-hmm. Support them. Right now, there's a big political, like we have Republicans and Democrats here. Mm-hmm. In the Middle East, there's a big split between what approach to take. Some people want to side with the Syrian government and Iran, and some want to side with the Western countries, mm-hmm. America, and Saudi Arabia. And so that's dividing the people, naturally, the people of Lebanon.
Right.
They call the two groups the March 14th and the mm-hmm. March 8th group, like our Democrats and Republicans.
Yes.
However, what's most amazing is that something is still very, very beautiful in this fragile democracy that is Lebanon,
okay.
where Christians and Muslims live on equal footing.
Bishop, let's leave it on that very encouraging note, knowing full well that there is so much more that we need to know and we need to do in the region. But thank you so much for joining us. I really
thank
appreciate
you, Liz.
It. Thank you. Bishop Gregory Mansour of the Eparchy of St. Maron of Brooklyn. Net will provide special coverage throughout the Pope's visit to Lebanon, so stick with us there. There's more Currents coming up. We'll take you to a special celebration for Maronite Catholics next. the saint who was honored from Brooklyn to Beirut.
Because of his spirituality, because of his humility and his priestly ways, he attracted many people to Christ.
Welcome back. The Pope is expected to focus much of his mission to the Middle East on the dangers facing Christians there. Now, although Christian presence in the region is ancient, predating that of the Muslims, persecution and discrimination have left the remaining faithful in peril. In his airport remarks this morning, the Pope pointed to the inspiration of St. Maron, the patron saint of the Maronite Catholic Church, and a saint, as we hear now, who is one of the great unknown saints of all time. We learned more when we headed to a special celebration last year to mark the death of St. Maron. It took place at Our Lady of Lebanon Cathedral in Brooklyn Heights.
Today is a special day, 1600 years since the passing of who we call Mar Maron. And he continues today to inspire the Maronite Church to holiness.
St. Maron is one of the great unknown saints. In the church. St. Maron gave his name to the Maronite church, but he was a priest, a hermit, an ascetic. He was one of the first in that region of northern Syria.
Because of his spirituality, because of his humility and his priestly ways, he attracted many people to Christ.
And by this rich generosity of the first Maronites, came this monastic movement that evangelized all of the Middle East and has come to us today.
Christianity is now a kind of a minority in the Middle East. It still is indigenous. It always was. It was there before Islam. But in its minority status, some of the Islamic countries are very stringent in the freedoms that they offer to Catholics and Christians of the Middle East.
There's always been this persecution of the Christians in that area of the world. And so as a result, there's always been migration to other places, but they brought with them their faith, their tradition.
Right now, the amazing communion that exists among 21 Eastern Catholic churches and one Western called the Latin Church. It's an amazing unity, and it was shown very beautifully in the Synod last year, last October, for the Middle East, because there you had all the different patriarchs and bishops and priests from the different churches throughout the Middle East, and they were all in communion with the Holy Father. And true to every good Eastern Christian, there's hospitality at the altar of Christ and there's hospitality at the table. So we invite everybody for a little meal afterwards.
It's a special celebration. We celebrate it in Lebanon. It's actually a national holiday. All the schools are closed. All the government closed their office. And we would like to do the same here in the United States in our community of faith.
Stay tuned. More currents in a moment. The Declaration of Religious Liberty crosses the river from Manhattan to Brooklyn.
The whole philosophy of the Manhattan Declaration is about that we're trying to convince others of the correctness of our position.
Welcome back. The Manhattan Declaration is a call issued to all Christians to give their support to the ongoing fight to preserve religious liberty in this country. Now, as we hear in this edition of Into the Deep with Bishop DiMarzio, next Thursday, September 20th, the Declaration crosses the river and comes to Queens. Bishop DiMarzio in the studio again. Thank you so much. We really appreciate having you here. The Manhattan Declaration. For those of us who don't know about this very important project, can you give us just a little bit of history about it?
Well, it's about 3 years almost, or maybe a little less. This is a movement that has come about. It's an ecumenical movement, interreligious movement also, because there's more than Christians involved, trying to establish the civic understanding of marriage, right to life, sanctity of life, all of these things will be put into one, to this kind of a thing. One of the originators is Chuck Colson, who underwent a great conversion in his life. He was one of the leaders. He unfortunately died not too long ago. But there are other leaders, I think, that have come together. And there was a meeting in Manhattan about 2 years ago. I attended it myself, where the declaration was put out there to bring people together with this one value, to understand marriage itself as between a man and a woman, and go down the list of all the things that were challenged in our society. So basically, it's kind of a Magna Carta, you know, in a certain sense, saying this is what we believe as people of faith, of different faiths. We agree on this. We want to work towards seeing that our society respects these values that are our values. Maybe people have other values, but at the same time, we want respect for our values so that they can be freely exercised and not constrained as what's happening today.
And we've planned a very big event. I'm very excited and looking forward to it. Can you tell us a little bit about what we can expect?
Well, there is an event taking place at St. John's University. Mm-hmm. I'll be there. I'll be celebrating the Mass at that time, giving a homily. But there are a lot of speakers that are competent in this area, trying to get people an understanding of how to have in the public forum our values understood. For example, there'll be someone speaking about the issue of same-sex marriage and how states have been able to, with referendums, to preserve that, and what can be done when the state has already given over that right to other people. And how do you balance it? And so there'll be speakers in the various areas, and again, it's interreligious, ecumenical, so there'll be a lot of different views, but with some common ground to center us.
We hear so much about the principles that are going to be addressed at the Manhattan Declaration: religious liberty, the sanctity of life, marriage. We hear it, but I don't know if we really understand it. Have we lost our way in understanding that these are the foundation of our faith and of life itself?
Unfortunately, I think people have given in to the idea that as long as something doesn't bother me, well, you do what you want. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a misunderstanding of society, I think, that somehow we have individual rights, but there are no communal rights. We are focused on the individual. Whatever the individual wants to do, long as it doesn't infringe on somebody else's rights, it's okay. And that's a mistake, because that's not society. That's isolationism. And I think that's the fallacy that we've fallen into today, that that's the way it is, and that's the way it will be, since I shouldn't express my opinion, since it's a pluralistic society. Well, I believe in a pluralistic society, but at the same time, it doesn't mean that I have to keep my opinions to myself, that mm-hmm. I can't voice them, that maybe I can convince other people of the rightness of my position. So we have a responsibility to try to do that, and I think this is part of what the whole philosophy of the Manhattan Declaration is about, that we're trying to convince others of the correctness of our position mm-hmm. by enunciating it clearly, by thinking through all of the issues, by not making it simplistic, which has happened. You know, it just is a question of rights. This is a human right. You can't take away rights. Well, nobody wants to deprive anybody of a right, mm-hmm. but is it a right, or is it a misunderstanding of what a right is? So this is why we do need to study this better, to be able to better explain and the communications world we live in of what we really are talking about.
One of the things that, as I've gotten to know you, Bishop DiMarzio, that I admire so much about you is you're very educated about the what's going on in the world and what affects us as Catholics in the world. And you not only talk about it, but you get involved and you encourage people to get involved. With regard to the Manhattan Declaration, how can we get our viewers involved, encourage them to be part of this?
Well, you know, you can go on the internet and see it, you know, you can read it, what it is. It's not a complicated statement, but people can sign on to it. You know, it is open to anybody to say, this is what I believe. The more people that are behind it, it's an important thing. So, and the St. John's event, I think, is open mm-hmm. to most people. I think, I don't know exactly what the limits are, But there, you know, you can attend that. There are many ways to get involved. And again, the more we know, the better chance we have of communicating our values to others.
All right. Thank you, Bishop. I will see you at that St. John's
okay,
event.
Okay, great.
Until then, thank you so much for joining us.
Good to be with you.
And remember, the Manhattan Declaration crosses the river next Thursday, September 20th, beginning at 12:15 p.m. at St. John's University. Stay with us. More Currents next.
Special memorials honoring the heroes that we lost.
Thank you to all of you, my fellow Americans, for being here to remember the events that shook this city, this state, and this nation 11 years ago.
Welcome back. I'm Liz Faubliss. As we conclude our week in review, we remember September 11th. Many people attended two memorial services led by State Senator Martin Golden to remember those who died on September 11th, 2001. We were there at the ceremony in Bay Ridge on the 69th Street Pier to be inspired, entertained, and led in prayer.
Lord, we need a healing wind to blow across our hearts, a gentle wisp from your lips to sheathe the aching parts. Every autumn is still the same since that sorrow-filled September. Our hearts are full of bitter holes that bleed when we remember.
Well, tonight is a very special night, especially here in Bay Ridge, because we truly suffered a great wound when it came to the 9/11 attacks. These were our brothers, our sisters, fathers, mothers, friends, co-workers, everything.
Thank you to all of you, my fellow Americans, for being here to remember the events that shook this city, this state, and this nation 11 years ago today.
Well, this is my hometown, and plus we do have that awesome view of the World Trade Center, which I remember as a boy. And I gotta tell you, each day going to work, I miss those towers. It was like a family member.
On 9/11, two planes crashed into those buildings. My son raced down there. He was working out a four engine right around the corner down in Front Street. I raced over there and I knew he was there. His car was outside quarters. I looked into the firehouse on Front Street and all the shoes were laying there and all the rigs were gone. And both towers had just fallen and I was, you know, heartbroken. Yeah, I knew, I thought he was dead. He was.
We want to make sure that we never, ever forget that terrible, terrible event. And today was really, truly a blessing because not only do we have the privilege of having Jimmy Ritchie's here and so many people attend, but when we released the balloons into the air, it is the first time those balloons went right over the site of 9/11.
It's very powerful. And it's always going to be powerful. It's never going to go away. And I'm glad. I'm glad it's not. It's good that we can step back and think about it, pray about it, and maybe make a deeper commitment to be people of justice and peace. That was the reminder that we talked about a lot with our own people.
So it brings back memories. It's going to continue to bring back those memories. We're never going to let this happen again in this nation, and that's what we're going to do, is to keep to remember and to have our history for many, many generations to come, to let our children know in our families and in our educational process to make sure that a tragedy like this never befalls this great nation again.
My hope is that we continue to teach and we continue to share and to make sure that those people aren't ever forgotten and that we find a way to bring people together to make, to only bring positive change in the world.
And that was Sergeant Louis Lacalzi of the 344th Combat Support Hospital. We actually end tonight's show with more from Sergeant Lacalzi. For all of us here at Currents, I'm Liz Faubliss. Thank you for watching and have a good night.
There. Thank you, Sergeant. Thank you, everybody. God bless America.